Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening from UNESCO headquarters in Paris. Welcome to the first webinar on climate change education for social transformation. My name is Jun Morohashi. I'm program specialist at Section for Education for Sustainable Development, Education Sector, UNESCO. And I'm very pleased to moderate the first part of today's discussion. Please note that this session provides interpretation in French. And please press the globe button on the bottom of your screen. First of all, I would like to invite Ms. Vibeke Jensen, Director of Division for Peace and Sustainable Development at UNESCO, and also Ms. Ina Parvanova, Director of Communications and Engagement at UNFCCC, to give welcome remarks. Vibeke, you have the floor, followed by Ms. Parvanova.
Thank you, and thank you so much, June, and good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, and a very warm welcome to all of you to this first in a series of webinars on climate change education for social transformation on the road to COP27, which is organized by UNFCCC and UNESCO. We are going to organize 8 conversations, one every last Tuesday of the month from now on to November, in the lead up to the COP27, which you probably all know will be organized in Egypt in November 22. And the webinars are open to basically all citizens from around the world to reflect on the role and the need for education in addressing and contributing to finding solutions to the climate crisis. Today's first webinar is to set the scene of the whole series, but also to explore the critical role of education in promoting social transformation through individual action, but also through societal restructuring to imagine more sustainable futures. And also to review the gaps, the challenges, and also opportunities in current education and sustainable development policies and curricula. UNESCO is leading the global education response to tackle the planetary crisis through the framework Education for Sustainable Development towards achieving the SDGs, which is also sometimes called ESD for 2030. And the UNESCO World Conference on Education for Sustainable Development, organized last spring in Berlin, and the first ever joint ministerial session of ministers of education and environment on climate change education at the COP26 in Glasgow last year, had demonstrated the commitment of education and environment stakeholders to tangibly promote climate change education. And I think some links to some of these events and key documents are being posted in the chat for you to have a closer look. But all of this is, of course, not enough. Recent UNESCO data from 100 countries show that nearly half of the world's national education curricula do not make any reference to climate change. And when the subject is mentioned, the depth is really minimal. Furthermore, fewer than 40% of teachers surveyed by UNESCO and Education International were confident in teaching about the severity of climate change. When asked about climate action, only 20% out of 58,000 teachers surveyed reported that they were familiar with explaining it. So we have a lot of work to do, and time is really running out. Therefore, we want to dedicate this month's webinar to deep diving into the meaning of climate change education and how it can help us respond to the climate crisis. Through climate change education, we'll enable individuals to be agents of change, as well as acquire the knowledge, the skills, the values, and attitudes that lead to a green transition of our societies. I would also like to take this opportunity to really thank UNFCCC for the long-standing collaboration on action for climate empowerment, including climate change education, and for your continuous support in organizing this series of webinars on the road to COP27. It's always been a great pleasure to work with you. And thank you to all of you for joining us today. I hope you'll enjoy the conversation. Thank you.
Sorry, I We're still muted. Thank you, our colleagues at UNESCO. I hope you can hear me, for organizing this webinar with us. Climate change is the most significant, alarming, and rapidly escalating crisis facing humanity. While it advances exponentially, humanity responds incrementally. The role of climate change education is increasingly being recognized as a fundamental enabler in meeting the goals of the Paris Agreement. Some experts are calling strengthening of climate education one of the social tipping elements that can rapidly transform our society and put it in the right direction. IPCC report also reaffirms that education, along with information and community approaches, including those informed by indigenous and local knowledge, can accelerate and can accelerate the wide-scale behavior changes consistent with adapting to and limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees. It is clear that climate change education can play a key role in both adaptation and mitigation. It enables learners to be future literate, to be equipped with knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes that guide us to low-carbon, climate-resilient economies and societies. IPCC also states that there is a high agreement in the literature that updating educational systems from a commercialized, individualized, entrepreneurial training model to an education cognizant of planetary health and human well-being can accelerate climate change awareness and action. This webinar series aims exactly to examine what this updated educational system should look like. Within the UNFCCC process, Article 6 of the Convention and Article 12 of the Paris Agreement, jointly named as Action for Climate Empowerment, call upon governments to increase their efforts in delivering climate education and public awareness, training, public participation and access to information, and international cooperation in those areas. That is to say, governments have the mandate to educate, equip, and empower learners of all ages, especially young people, through climate education and training to facilitate a green social transformation. In order to deliver this transformation, strong interdisciplinary and multi-stakeholder partnerships should be established. These partnerships will allow diverse actors to work in equitable, just, and enabling ways to reconcile divergent interests, values and worldviews toward more equitable and just outcomes that advance climate resilient development. And this is what Action for Climate Empowerment is trying to fulfill through its intrinsically linked six elements. I wish you all fruitful discussions in this webinar series and hope to see your views, ideas and solutions reflected in COP27 and beyond to foster the social transformation we desperately need to save our planet. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vibeke, and also Ms. Parvanova for your welcome remarks. And today's topic is the role of education to address the climate crisis in particular around the following two key questions that we prepared. So the first one, what is the role of education as a key response to the climate crisis? And what should transformative climate change education look like? The second question is, what are the challenges countries face in integrating climate change education into education policies and curriculum? And how can this be overcome to have climate-ready education systems? The discussion will start with interviews. I wanted to say the discussion will start with interviews with the panelists here with us today and followed by moderated Q&A session. And before we begin, I would like to introduce you to a tool that we'll be using today during the session to engage all of you, the participants joining from all over the world. Thank you for being with us today. You can go to Slido, so slido.com. I think you can see it on the screen and enter the event code, which is 669305, as shown on the screen. And this tool will help you for two things. So first is to feed in your inputs to some questions that will be raised during the panel discussion, but also secondly, to post your own questions throughout the session. And then you'll be invited also to choose the most relevant questions you want to see being addressed by the panelists, because we may have plenty of good questions from all of you. Now, I would like to pass this over to Alexander Leicht, Chief of ESD Section at UNESCO, for continued moderation. Over to you, Alexander. Thank you.
Thank you very much, June, and hello to everyone. I'm very happy to moderate the exciting panel discussion that we are having now. And for this, I would like to first introduce the panelists, and I would like to ask them also to switch on their cameras. First of all, Zulkifli Abdul Razal, the rector of the International Islamic University of Malaysia, and also the former president of IAU, the International Association of Universities. Then we have Antonia Wolf, the Director of Research, Policy and Advocacy of Education International. Education International, of course, the World Association of Teacher Unions, and really the global voice of teachers in these discussions. Sahar Rasid Baik, a global youth advocate for climate and right to a healthy environment, member of YANGO, the youth constituency of UNFCCC, and also very much engaged at the Youth for Climate Summit that was organized last year in Italy. And Daniela Tilbury, Commissioner for Sustainable Development and Future Generations of the Government of Gibraltar. She's an educator, policy expert, academic leader, for many years active in education for sustainable development, and also credited with developing the first framework in higher education in this area. So I'm very, very happy to have you all here, and I'm sure we will have a very, very interesting discussion. Before we go into the panel discussion, I wanted to use this tool that my colleague June just introduced and ask the audience basically for a first reaction to the question, what should transformative climate change education look like? So basically, I think we can see here already some responses. So for those who haven't typed anything yet, please go to the slido.com page, type 669305 as the meeting code, and then respond in the way you want to this question, what should transformative climate change education look like? I think holistic is one thing that stands out. Inclusive is something that stands out. Life-wide, interdisciplinary. I think a lot of very, very interesting responses. I think inclusive and holistic, and also global citizenship education, basically associated with a global citizenship mentality, is something that stands out. An education of hope, and of course, various responses here that refer to the kind of transdisciplinarity, multidisciplinarity, and the overall holistic approach. I think that's already quite exciting to see these first responses. And on the basis of those, I would go to the panel, and start with Sahar. And would like to sort of ask for your first response on what should transformative climate change education look like. Sahar, over to you.
Thank you so much, Alexander. And I would like to start by first of all conveying my appreciation to UNESCO and the UNFCCC on organizing these consistent series till COP27, UNESCO Ministerial Summit in Milan at Youth for Climate, and COP26, as well as the Transformative Education Forum, have been great examples of bringing climate education to the table while meaningfully including the voices of the youth. Hence, I have faith that these consistent series will put forward concrete policy demands to save the children, youth, and future generations. Now, I would like to highlight some points from the Youth for Climate Manifesto, which has the collective voices of young people from all corners of the world. Climate literacy is really defined as the breakthrough to empower people of all ages with the knowledge, skills, values, and attitudes to address climate change. Transformative education most ideally can be seen as the inclusive and collaborative education that has a holistic approach, integrating indigenous and local knowledge, gender perspective, and promoting changes in lifestyles, attitudes, and behavior, ensuring climate neutrality and climate resilience of educational institutions. And being from the Global South myself, I cannot emphasize on the last part enough. It can be done by strengthening public and transparent consultation processes of marginalized and less involved communities and groups at local levels, involving, among others, representatives groups of educational institutions, civil society actors, indigenous people, climate change advocates, women, migrants, and refugees. And above all, young members of local communities, increasing that are helping increase awareness, networking, and building expertise for the future. In its most basic form, general climate education is already cemented in the Paris Agreement under Action for Climate Empowerment, ACE. ACE is composed of six elements: education, training, public awareness and public participation, public awareness to information and international collaboration that are necessary to empower all communities to see themselves as part of the solution to the climate crisis. For education to make the most impact, it is essential that climate education is mandated in all school systems. In doing so, it is also important that we move away from education systems reliant on strict memorization and spending 8 hours inside a classroom, towards a project-based and experience-based education that incorporates science and traditional knowledge that can help inspire learners to understand how to make an impact in their communities. Education should not only focus on mitigation, but on adaptation and historical root causes such as colonization that led to the climate crisis at the first place. Further, as proposed in the YOUNGO's ACE Working Group submission, which is a very diverse group of young people dedicated to action for climate empowerment, all education materials should be translated into local languages to ensure accessibility. Thank you, Alexander. I pass it on to you.
Great. Thank you very much, Saha, for this very, very strong plea, you know, from a youth perspective, also in the sense, not only in the sense that youth are the ones that are the most affected by climate change, but also are the ones who really drive educational innovation. And I think you have very, very well explained what this education could look like. I'm moving on to Zul for your responses to what this type of education that we're looking for should look like. Over to you.
Thank you, Alexander. I think Saha has said a whole lot, which I think is very relevant to what we are going to talk about as far as the form of education related to climate change. But I just want to tease a number of points. One is, I think this whole idea of being transdisciplinary is something which is very important, because I look at climate change is a net effect of all the knowledge that we are teaching our students in a compartmentalized way. Look at science and technology. If you teach it in a very compartmentalized way, the impact will be different if you teach it in a very collective or transdisciplinary way. Same in economics or geography or whatever it is. So I think the whole idea that things must come together. There's no longer, for example, in Malaysia, you've got University of Science, University of Technology, University of Agriculture. Those kind of nomenclature, I think, is no longer relevant. You must find a kind of a common understanding where everybody, there's one knowledge that everybody must know. And this is the kind of a minimum package, you know, as far as climate change is concerned. So you can use the word holistic, you can use the word inclusive. All these, I think, means the same, that what is that package of knowledge that everybody must have to start off with before we can even go into the deeper understanding of what climate change and climate crisis is all about. The second part, I think, is a question of values. I think this is where the tricky part is. Different countries, different nation, different society have different sort of impact as far as climate change is concerned. In Malaysia, we will never understand what snow is all about. And therefore, the understanding of what climate change is within our own domain, within our own cultural dimension, becomes a signal of what climate change is all about. If we're talking about melting glaciers, we will never see them. And therefore, we need to talk about a flood, for example, the kind of rain that comes in very frequently in the severity. So what is the signal, that key point that you want to look at as far as climate change is concerned, so that suddenly you're connected to it, you know? You suddenly realize the thing has different, climate is different, and understanding it within your own context. And on that note, I think you need to personalize it. And I talk about personalized means, if you talk about climate change as everybody's problem, then it becomes nobody's problem. So how do you personalize it, and how do you become sensitive personally in the context of a lifestyle? And this is where values come in. And then the question of values comes in to associate it with your own lifestyle, your own priority, and even your own cultural dimension. So the code of value education becomes important. So we talk about transdisciplinary, you talk about how do you personalize it as a lifestyle, and based on your own norms, your own values, and your own kind of understanding of what climate change is within your environment and your community. I think that's a basic that we need to have. Once that is done and we understand this as something which is happening every day. It is not something that happens seasonally. Now it's happening every day. And how do you then take this, move forward into the pedagogical kind of understanding? And I do agree with Sahel, we need now to move out of the classroom. To experience climate is out of the classroom, not in the classroom, not in air-conditioned rooms and things like that. And how do you also make this transition? That's all for me for now, Alexander.
Great. Thank you very much, Zul, for this also very ambitious program and comprehensive program for climate education. I think it also shows how far away we still are in terms of what we want to see in education systems. I think it's also something that Vibeke pointed out at the beginning. Let me just, before moving on the panel, remind the audience and everyone that you can raise your own questions to the panel that later on I will try to pick out a few by using the Q&A tab on the Slido tool that we used earlier. So just for everyone also to give the opportunity to ask questions. But I'm moving on now on the panel, turning to Antonia from Education International, and I'm asking you for your perspective on sort of what this type of education on climate change should look like.
Great. Thanks so much, Alexander. And thanks also to Saher and Sul for kicking us off in a really good way. And I'm happy to elaborate and add to your reflection. So we're really looking at education as a precondition for understanding how we got here, what's at stake, and what we need to do now. And Education International has agreed on a quality climate change manifesto that outlines the minimum package that Sul called it, what we need to have in place. And we understand quality climate change education to be based on science, but to also address the ethical, the cultural, the political, social, economic dimensions of climate change. And this means that climate change education doesn't shy away from the more controversial issues related to climate change, but it addresses the question of the very unequal contributions of countries. It recognizes that the system is deeply inequitable, deeply unfair. It takes a gender-responsive approach. It recognizes indigenous knowledge. And it recognizes that vulnerable populations are the most affected. So this is really a courageous form of education as well, and one that challenges all of us, teachers as well as students, systems, as well as politicians. And I think I would want to challenge Sul's point about having to move out of the classrooms, because while I understand what you mean, I think we also need to move back into the classrooms, and we need to reclaim the power of classrooms, the potential of classrooms, in really addressing climate change. And I think that means that we need to have this discussion in a way that also recognizes some of the some of the work that is still in progress in really making education equitable and inclusive. And that means that quality climate change education, it requires public education systems, quality public education systems, so that we can really ensure that no student leaves school without being climate literate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Antonia, also for really pointing out that we cannot sort of escape controversy when we talk about ambitious climate education, because if we argue the sort of that whole economic and social systems should change and that will lead to some resistance, how should it be different in education? I think that's a very important point also. On to Daniela, please, for your perspective on climate education.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank UNESCO and UFCCC for coming together to discuss this such an important aspect of schooling, of education, of university work. We need to transform and not just learn about the science. And I think that's why I'm really engaged with this particular panel. I'd like to start off by saying that we're very aware of the reports and the high-level statements that highlight that urgency that we need to change these education systems so that they themselves can transform society. But despite expectations being very high, we are simply just adding more content. We are simply adding more science to the curriculum and therefore failing our students as in the not just our students, but also the planet. And this is why I want to make a plea that the education looking forward must be educational above everything else, and not just environmental or focused on climate benefits. It must be educational. The Greta and the Fridays for Climate movement exemplifies how our current education system is failing our young people. Greta's generation is right to be angry, in my view. They're frustrated, they're disengaged. They are protesting on the streets because they don't know yet how to influence change, how to make change possible, not just in their schools, but also in our societies. We have a situation where the curriculum focuses so much on knowledge and understanding and on teaching of the science, that we, and on explaining how the world is rather than how the world could be, that we have a situation where they don't have the skills, even though they have the will, to make a more sustainable future. This means that they build frustration, they build concern in young people. So to counter that, we must bring education back into climate change education, and not just climate science. That will bring the transformative edge. And I think this is missed by a lot of the advocates, because what we find is that there are a lot of core messages being communicated out to students, and there's very little opportunity for learners, for example, to interrogate or to engage with the assumptions that are underpinning these messages. We just say, no, you know, you must recycle, or you must do this. This is part of being or leading a good, sustainable life. But actually, the value positions, the understanding of the person that is receiving these messages, there has to be a process in education where all this gets unpacked so that the students have the skills of whatever else is coming their way to actually interrogate and change the future. To me, if we miss out this educational principles out of climate education, we find that the students are actually analyzing, understanding the landscape or the world as it is changing, but they have very little skills to actually shape this world as it changes. So for me, when you ask me that question, let's bring back education into climate ed.
Great, Daniela. Excellent point. Thank you very much. The strong plea to really sort of focus on the educational dimension and really in particular activate students and empower them to really take action and not just hammer in kind of messages to do this or that and recycle here and there, but to really empower them. Also, as panelists have said earlier, also for kind of societal and political action, because it will be only at that level in the end that the big shifts will happen. So I think we've heard a lot of very, very rich elements for an ambitious program on climate education from the panel so far. And I would like to now move on to the second round, to the second question that will talk about sort of the key challenges that we are encountering in implementing this type of education. And for this, I would like to ask again all the participants to use their Slido tool. So you can go to slido.com, put in the code 669305, and then respond to the question, what are the main challenges in integrating climate change education into policies and the curriculum? So the issue of controversial aims, basically, that there may not be like entire political agreement on what climate change education should look like, is one of the things popping up. Lack of political will also, that resonates with this earlier point. Curriculum overload, also something that is often mentioned. Political will, I think, is coming out more strongly now. And also the issue of outdated education systems, basically that they're not education systems are not really compatible anymore for this big shift and this big change that is needed. So I think the lack of funding also important. So I think we can see a couple of main items here around the lack of political will and the issue of, you know, different political and economic interests, which resonates with a lot of what the four panelists have said. And in light of this, I would like to go back to the panel and really ask about your responses on how to overcome these challenges. You can see here a very rich list of challenges, and you will have your own thinking on them. And I'd like to hear some responses on how to overcome these challenges from the perspective of your work and your organization. And I'll start with Antonia from Education International.
Thanks. So we've done two pieces of research in the past 2 years, and one of them was showing that education remains a kind of unrecognized part of countries' climate strategies. So I think there's one piece around really becoming serious with a commitment to climate change education as part of climate strategies. And then the second was a piece that EI did together with UNESCO that looked at teachers and teachers' preparedness. And there were some really quite shocking findings in there that I wanted to share with you, because we found that 95% of the surveyed teachers were motivated to teach about climate change, but only 55% said that they had received training on how to do this, and less than 40% said that they were confident teaching about climate change. And I think this less than 40% is really the figure that I'd like to stay in all of your minds, and really showing us how urgent it is to look at teachers and the education workforce and the ways in which we can support teachers. So this is about initial teacher training, but it's also about supporting the teachers that are already in the system. So different forms of continuous professional development and support. And of course, there is a big, big piece of work to do around updating national education policy and curricula, ensuring that climate change education is part of all levels of education, that it's part of all subjects, going back to what Sul was talking about earlier, really challenging the notion about these separate subjects that we all have to learn. And then just a last reflection, I think a conversation we're having within our membership is one about professional autonomy, the extent to which teachers are able to decide what and how they teach, and a growing number of teachers that do feel that there is pressure on them, in part because of systems that are much kind of structured around quite a limited number of core subjects standardized testing, in part because of a more controversial political pressure that some teachers are reporting, experiencing it to be difficult, if not impossible, to address controversial subjects such as climate change. So that's really something I want to highlight as well, that there are also those teachers who would like to, but who feel they are not able to. Thanks.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Antonia, for speaking so clearly about sort of the challenges that in particular teachers are facing. I'm moving on to Zul for your perspective on the challenges and possibly how we can respond to them. You're muted, I think, Zul. You're muted.
Okay, thank you. It's a big question, but I think my point is basically it's about the structural problem. In other words, Diana and I talk about school. What is school now? What is education now? I think we have taken education and school into a context which we cannot recognize it anymore. I remember a book by Ivan Illich, I think, talked about de-schooling, for example. Do we really need school the way we understand what school is all about? This way I'm going to go back to we need to go out of the school, quote unquote, because the whole environment is a school. At times when there is no school in Malaysia, we use the tree as a school. And therefore, we understand better what is happening around us because we are stuck right in the smack in the environment, as it were, without these walls and stuff like that. So, this is conceptually what is the barrier that we need to address as far as education and schooling is concerned. And therefore, the whole idea of learning everywhere. In other words, wherever you go, the climate change will be with you, regardless what structure you talked about. And the more you interact with the environment you are in, the better educated you are. And sometimes the interaction can come in a form which is not very formal. And therefore, again, you must understand how to learn, not just formally, but also informally and non-formally. These are all done in a very compartmentalized way now. How do you bring this together so that we have a convergence of what education is all about and how it is carried on? This is done in medical sciences. When I was in the medical school, we talk about it in a different form, physiology, anatomy, pathology, and so on and so forth. Now we use an integrated curriculum, those are no longer there. We use the human body. So you must understand when you talk about a disease, you must understand all these aspects together. And how do you do this for climate change and climate crisis to understand everything these are all things that are connected with one another. It cannot survive on its own. How do you integrate it, I think, is the barrier that you want to talk about. And as far as the political view is concerned, I am very, very concerned because education in our parts of the world is becoming more and more private. It becomes more and more political in that particular sense. And therefore, the notion of education becomes a market, become things that, you know, then things that you can buy and sell. It is no longer a public good, as it were. And therefore, the push is towards those kind of a thing. And therefore, it becomes very economic-centric, it becomes very industrial-led, and the society and the community that bears a different kind of information does not get told in school as such. So how do you push back and say that education is a public good, that everybody is entitled to it, that we have common values and common problems that we need to tackle together rather than segmenting it? This is a private education and therefore it teaches in a very different way, very elitist, and therefore the whole notion of climate change sometimes is lost on those discussions. That's my point for now, Alex. Thanks.
Great, thank you. Excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much, Zul. Let me move on to Daniela for her perspective on the challenges and how to overcome them. Some key challenges, Daniela.
Thank you. I agree with both panelists so far in terms of the importance of de-schooling, but also the fact that teacher autonomy is actually a key challenge. So, I'd like to add three very brief points to that. And one of them is the omission of futures education as a key challenge. To me, we're missing that type of education that brings hope, that brings positivity, that brings the alternatives to the way in which we, well, the fact that we are facing quite dark futures and that we need to create alternatives. It doesn't have to be the way that the IPCC reports record. You know, it doesn't have to be like that. But for us to move away from that, we have to create education systems and educational policies that shift our current education so that they, the learning does not just, or the schools do not just serve as mirrors of our current community, but that they serve as lighthouses. They're lighting new paths forward, new futures forward. And the current status quo is that very much of schools reproducing the current tensions that we have with people and planet. And this is a key challenge for us because they do very little to help learners get out of the challenges that we're currently facing. The very quickly, the second one is the importance of interdisciplinarity. And this requires a whole school approach. And at a policy level, this is really important because we have sometimes separate departments that actually look at, government departments that look at the school, the curriculum, the teacher training, and sometimes even school grounds. So the policy challenge here is to find bridges so that government departments at the national level, at the regional level, can work together in the same way that we're expecting schools to come together to develop holistic approaches or whole school approaches to sustainability. That is a key challenge. And finally, nature studies. Suddenly, we've reached the 2020s and everybody is just captivated by exposing our young children and our learners to nature and assuming that that is going to solve our problem. We need nature. We need nature studies in the same way that we need climate science. But these two in themselves do not constitute or substitute climate education. And that is the key challenge of our decade at the moment. We need to build on that and make sure we do not lose the edge of climate change education, which is much more than just connecting with nature, is understanding how our daily lives, our daily decisions in our environments, in our home, in our work, at play, influence the future that we would like. And that is not always about going out and understanding nature or connecting practically with nature. So for me, these are quite big challenges.
Thank you, Daniela. Excellent points, really. And also thank you for sort of warning against a kind of more like naive version of this kind of climate education that is maybe only associated with nature or only associated with science and thinks this will bring the solutions. Also, thank you very much. I'll move on to Saher for your perspective on the challenges and maybe some responses to those challenges.
Yes, thank you so much, Alexander. I would like to focus on two main challenges that I also saw on the Slido responses as well, and super glad to see that the young people are also highlighting them here as well. So challenge number one is that many countries have received high-level barriers to promoting climate education. The resources to educate on climate change already exist. Everyone just needs resources such as funding and human power to improve those tools that make it easy for climate education to be integrated everywhere. The potential solution to this problem, to this challenge, can be that we create more opportunities for young people to provide climate education trainings, scholarships for higher education, and participate as researchers and climate educators can help young people realize their full potential, right? Thereby bolstering education on climate that can permeate within communities as well. One example of this can be promoting awareness about YUNGO, which is the official children youth constituency of the UNFCCC, among the youth and parties, as well as increasing support financially, logistically, and institutionally to the virtual, local, and global conferences of youth. As they focused on extensive capacity building and making the youth able to give policy inputs. The challenge number two, as I would like to put, is that climate education is seen as something only important for younger generation, despite the fact that the leaders making the decisions on climate never had any access or even awareness to climate change growing up. The potential solution to this can be that we recognize that climate education is not limited to young people only. We should be developing training models, local and national databases on climate education tools, and doing whatever it takes to ensure everybody is empowered to act with the climate crisis in mind now and in the future. Such as we can basically do, if we want to, I mean, as such, we want to see pathways for climate formal and non-formal education and peer-to-peer learning opportunities, including the most important reporting documents of the countries, such as the National Determined Contributions, the NDCs, and the National Adaptation Plans, promoting equal access to education in schools, universities, and vocational schools, as well as bringing the education career gap by providing skilled building programs, access to mentorship, and peer-to-peer learning, and using a system approach to building the clean energy and workforce is also essential. And just once again, would like to highlight and appreciate all the young people present here today who recognize the barriers that they face and still contribute to the climate agenda very meaningfully. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Sahar, for that very strong plea. And you also addressed actually already one of the main questions that has come out through the Slido tool. And that's precisely the role of adult education and the importance of adult education. I think you've already given some indications on how to respond to that challenge. That actually it's not the young people who have created the issue. It is really the adults that first need to be educated. So I think that also already response to one of the concerns that has come up from the participants. I also see a number of questions that are asking for good practice examples. And here I can refer you to the later webinars in the series, because after this opening webinar, once a month we will come together again and there really discuss much more very specific examples of what works and what doesn't work on the ground. And in the meantime also, you can go to our website and you see a number of good practice examples from different countries listed. We have a few minutes still left, I think, to go back to the panel with questions from the audience. And one question is really asking about the role of education within the very big transformation that is needed. I mean, like we have spoken a lot about on the panel now about the transformation that is needed in education, basically, to achieve this, this ambitious climate education. But how does this sit? Is one question with all the other areas of society where major change is needed: gender equality, the economic structures, the political dimension, science maybe. So I think it's also a question about sort of potential partnerships between the education sector and other sectors. And if I can go back to the panel with this particular question, I think, which was the question that came out most strongly in the chat, and I, in the interest of time, would ask for short responses from the panel. And let me start maybe with Antonia, if it's okay.
Yeah, so I'm sitting here thinking that I don't know if I believe in that separation of things. I don't think we can discuss climate change without also discussing gender equality. We can't discuss climate change without looking at economic justice and the way that resources are distributed and used today. So in some ways, I think we need to maybe flip the question around and really look at how we can make some of these urgent changes in education, knowing that change in education is a slow process, knowing that systems are sometimes heavy to move. And I really, unsurprisingly, I'd speak about the role of the profession, the role of teachers and their unions, the role of students and their unions to really lead the way on rethinking education and ensuring that it responds to the very, very urgent questions, concerns, needs that children and young people feel today, because you can't think that they can be protected from the scary reality of the climate crisis we need to address it, and we need to do it in a respectful way of children and young people as people with a legitimate perspective, legitimate concerns, legitimate questions. So I really think this is a change that needs to be led by students and teachers. And that means that we need to be able to trust the political system, governments, to really come in here behind us and start delivering on the commitments that they've been making for decades.
Great. Thank you very much, Antonia, for a kind of also a hopeful perspective, you know, with teachers and the profession and students themselves being really the drivers and being maybe also those who can really more explicitly address the controversial political issues that others in the education system may have more difficulty with addressing. Let me move on to Zul, if I may, sort of your thoughts on sort of how to connect the big transformation that is needed in education with other sort of transformations that are needed in other parts of society.
Yeah, basically, I'm quite optimistic on this. I mean, when we look at the 17 SDGs, I think it's already there. You look at SDG 13, it's already about climate action. You know, but how many of us focus on SDG 13 as such? Because we in the university somehow or other focus on SDG 4, because that is the only one that we can recognize quite readily. So I think we need to use the same framework. In other words, how do you connect this? We don't have to reinvent another one. And as you talk about education for sustainable development, now you probably want to talk about education for climate change, not about climate change, not on climate change, for climate change. So the thinking is the same. It's a method of the pieces may be different, the emphasis may be different, but the approach, the mental approach of being holistically together and connecting things together, the things that you talked about are all already in the 17 SDGs. It's a matter of just picking it up and plugging into the right thing. So, for example, education about health, about well-being, about poverty, about equality, about consumption, all these has to be related to climate change at the end of the day. So if you think along those lines, I think we already got the solution half-made. It's a question of just reorienting it. Perhaps we will get there sooner than we anticipate. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Daniela. Your short comments on this
yes,
big challenge.
I'll keep it very brief. I think all of these different educations are asking for the same thing. They're asking for educational reform. They're asking for decolonization of our curriculum. They're asking for a shift in the power dynamics between the teacher and the learner. They're asking for the same thing. So I guess the core question is, how do we achieve it? And I think we achieve it by involving young people and young teachers with a different perspective on education in the design of educational policies and curriculum. And unless we do that, we're going to be stranded with the old models of education. So we need to create situations where the voice of young people, young learners, and the beneficiaries of the educational systems come into that process, because at the moment they are underrepresented. And there's a lot of influences from scientists, NGOs, but those who are directly benefiting are not in that power dynamic, and that needs to change.
Excellent, Daniela. Thank you very much. And in that spirit, Sahar gets the last word on the panel for your short response to this question.
Yes, I really echo with whatever have been said here by all the panelists, and I'm really happy to see that the young people have the priority here. I just want to highlight one point that that Daniela also touched upon, which is that don't see young people that you're doing the things for. Rather see them that you can do things with, because they have the capacity and they recognize that the climate crisis is the existential crisis. So they have the potential. We just have to take them into these systems, as Antonio just mentioned, right? So that we can meaningfully and inclusively, just as Zul also mentioned, that the transformative education is, whatever word we give it, is inclusive and holistic. So I just think that the youth can, it should not only be for the youth, but also with the young people as well. And this is what I only want to highlight here. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Sahar, and thank you very much to you, to Antonia, to Zul, to Daniela for the very rich comments from the panel. I think it's been a very, very interesting discussion on a very, very ambitious program for climate education that doesn't really shy away from the big controversies, you know, including addressing economic systems and issues of political will. And I think you've also very nicely at the end provided some more optimistic perspectives on what could be next steps and potential allies. So thank you very much to the panel and to the audience. And I hand over to Fleur, my colleague from UNFCCC, for the closing remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alexander. And I'm very happy that the first session of this series of conversations has been full of energy and ideas to bring climate change education into the heart of educational systems, and to make climate resilient, low carbon and just societies a reality. As Alexander mentioned, this webinar series will have 7 more webinars scheduled for the last Tuesday of each month until November. The series will cover various dimensions of climate change education, ranging from the topic of green transitions and adaptation to the role of, all the way through to the role of youth and Indigenous communities across the world, all of which have been touched on today. These sessions will review the gaps, challenges, and opportunities in promoting climate change education for social transformation and feed into the discussions of the Transforming Education Summit in September and COP27 in November. Today's discussion will be published as a discussion paper and video recordings, which will be made available on the UNFCCC's ACE Hub page and UNESCO's webinar page. Our next webinar on 31 May at 2 p.m. Central European Summer Time will discuss how climate change knowledge can become action by reviewing the core skills, values and actions, as well as knowledge that are required for transformative climate change education that will bring about social change. And again, some of those have been touched on today. The same link, Zoom link, will be used for all series, and registration is available in the link shared in the chat. As usual, detailed announcements will be shared before the event on websites and newsletters. And before we close, this series is being delivered on also as part of the ASUP, which is a UNFCCC initiative supported by the German regional government of North Rhine-Westphalia. Apart from this amazing webinar series, other ACE and youth events are also being planned as a part of the ACE Hub to support the implementation of the Glasgow Work Programme on ACE, which was agreed at COP26 last year. Relevant information will be shared through our website. Before we close today's webinar, I just want to take this opportunity to thank Alexander for your contribution to the education for sustainable development, including as the section chief of ESD at UNESCO. For more than a decade, and wish you all the very best in your new post. This is definitely not a goodbye, and we look forward to our continuing collaboration to promote learning for sustainability. And on that note, I would ask Alexander if you'd like to take the floor again to say a few words.
Thank you very much, Fleur. Thank you very much for your kind words. And I just thank again everyone for the rich discussion today, all the participants. I think we had a couple of hundred really. And I wish you all the best, and I look forward to the next webinars. Thank you very much.